My title today is Taxation Development from the Wider Perspective. Basically, the background for this is that Tony, who's here, asked me to give some sort of overview of our research in the areas of tax policies and also, to some extent, social protection policies. So let me start from the introduction to this talk. So my approach today is going to be the following. How do the problems and the current research in taxation in developing countries look like from the point of view of somebody like me who has worked using conventional public economics tools for years and decades? And this conventional public economics includes, first of all, this sort of normative analysis on how a good tax system should be designed, and then also the more positive analysis on empirical work, a serious econometric work on trying to estimate the causal impact of changes in, for example, taxes, tax policies on economic behavior, things like labor supply, taxable income and savings. And then the idea is that how combining this background, we here at WIDER could come up with a research proposal that would serve then the purposes of getting useful policy relevant knowledge from the regarding developing countries. So the outline to my presentation now is that I'm going to first very briefly just remind you on what is this modern public economics approach to tax analysis. Then I have a few slides about the current stance of tax revenues in developing countries utilizing the great data sets that was presented by the ICTD colleagues here. And after that, I'm going to speak about the UNU-WIDER tax research. And unfortunately, I'm now speaking more about our plans rather than actual results. So it's a scary thought that the talk is videoed and somebody can keep me accountable for what I said after a couple of years and to see if we actually delivered on anything we promised to do. So if I'm not delivering, it's Tony's fault. That's obviously the answer. So let me start from the modern public economics approach to tax analysis, so also called as optimal tax analysis. So here the starting point is that the basic goal of the government is to collect revenues to finance public goods, and this should be done in a way that minimizes the tax distortions the tax system creates. And also at the same time, the tax and the social protection system should achieve whatever the distributional goals of the government has. So in principle, this gives rise to the basic efficiency equity trade-off that we need to have a balance between first of all minimizing the distortions and then achieving the distributional goals, because achieving some of the distributional goals could actually entail tax systems that creates distortions on for example things like employment. One feature which I would like to emphasize regarding this modern analysis of taxes is that we don't make any artificial distinction between taxes and transfers. So if you like, we can also see part of the expenditure side as taxes being and transfers being negative taxes. So in essence, the optimal tax models, when optimal redistribution is analyzed, covers both. Obviously, also taxes have a corrective role, but I'll skip that. Now, on the empirical work on the impacts of taxation, much of the current research actually emphasizes a notion called elasticity of taxable income, or ETI, which is defined as a percentage change in taxable income, TI, whenever the 1 minus the marginal tax rate or the retention rate increases by 1%. So the benefit of this approach is that, unlike some of the more traditional work, it captures also other potential margins of responses, how the taxpayers might respond to changes in taxes. They can relate to increases in effort or also issues like avoidance and evasion. They're all captured by this elasticity. For the developed countries, for the industrialized countries, in a sense, what are deemed as acceptable estimates of the ETI combine typically two things. One is the use of this large taxpayer register data, and the second one is some sort of an economic or tax policy reform which generates variation across taxpayers, which is fairly exogenous. So economists talk about credible identification strategies in these cases. Now, when we go to taxes in developing countries, this is the next small bit of my talk. This is an updated figure based, which also appeared in the working paper you referred to. But this is based now on the government revenue database, which was released this year, and this is the revenues. So this includes the total tax revenues, including social security contributions for these country groups. And you can see that there's clearly an increase even in the low-income countries in their tax take. The main thing is that they're still very much lacking behind in terms of the taxes out of the GDP on the currently rich countries. But the point is that when we go back far enough in history, countries which are currently rich also collected very, very little in terms of tax revenues. So this is a figure which I borrow from a handbook article by Wesley and Patterson on this, and then you can see that the taxes as a share of GDP were around the level where this tax ratio is nowadays in the developing countries. So a couple of observations based on this. So perhaps the main question in taxes and development is to how do countries go from raising approximately 10% of their revenues in taxes to something like 35-40%. So in other words, how do they obtain more tax capacity? So to me, because I'm trained in this optimal tax tradition, this is there's an interesting contrast. In the poor countries, we speak about that they should tax more. In the rich countries like Scandinavia, some people think that we are taxing too much. And we are very worried about the distortions taxes create. So this begs the question that where's the tipping point? So when do the countries start to actually tax in a sense too much depending on at least some of us opinions? The second observation I would like to point out that how should countries design their tax and transfer policies as a system when they start to actually go from the 10% towards the 40%. I skipped the remark on the field experiments because that was already covered in mixed talk, for example. I now go to the part where I say a few words about our current research agenda regarding taxes and social protection. So there we have four main themes. The first is motivated by this need and desire to see the tax and social protection system as an entity. And one tool to actually do this is to build what are called tax benefit microsimulation models. I come back to them in a minute what they are. The second thing what we try to do is motivated by the fact that we currently, as was pointed out by Mick already for here, that we currently know too little on the actual impacts of taxes on economic behavior in developing countries. And there we try to use tax authorities' registered data for providing more evidence on these things. Then one issue is obviously improving the data access also on macro tax variables. So we are committed to maintaining and conducting research using the ICTD government revenue database. And we also have a political economy angle. This is the last bullet point here. on we have a research program. I'm looking at some of the political hurdles countries may have when they build up the tax capacity and social protection system. There's a forthcoming symposium on political economy aspects to be held early next year. In this talk, I'm going to focus on two issues. One is the tax benefit microsimulation models, and the second one is using registered data to provide estimates, basically on the ETI, hopefully. I should mention that we also aim to conduct more theory work on designing cash transfer systems, on the normative analysis that in the Merle's tradition, and also we would like to hopefully carry out some also work on the international tax aspects, providing evidence on the extent of income shifting depending on how much countries actually tax the multinationals. So in a sense, trying to uncover this elasticity of income shifting. Okay, so with the few minutes I have, I would like to say something about the tax benefit microsimulation model building plans that we have. So these models combine two things. So they build on a representative household level data on income and expenditures, and then they also have a detailed coding of the tax and benefit legislation in the country. The word simulation refers to the fact that the user can design alternative type of policies and then simulate their impacts on income distribution, the overall government revenues, and for things like work incentives, marginal income tax rates or participation tax rates. The point is that these models are in everyday use in developed countries. And also, researchers find them useful because if you want to know the marginal tax rates, we don't have any other alternative than calculate this using microsimulation models. And obviously, these are essential for the developing countries once they try to go from scattered, isolated social protection programs to actual systems, because then you need to also have an idea on the system-wide impact of the policies, plus an idea how to finance all those. And a tax benefit microsimulation model is a tool to understand that. Yet, very few countries, actually in developing countries, have access to such tools. So what we try to do is in a joint undertaking with the Euromod team at the University of Essex and an institute called SASPRI, which is a Cape Town-based institute, is to develop these models for a set of developing countries. Why Euromod? Well, Euromod is both a macro-simulation model for the European countries, but it's also a statistical software for building micro-simulation models, and it improves, and it's also creating comparability of policies across countries. One final point in 2 minutes. So. And this is about the use of revenue administration data for tax research. We actually have very little published work on the impacts of taxes using credible identification strategies. The only paper, there's some work going on obviously by ICTD researchers on this, but the only published papers are two papers on Pakistan. But it's clear that Pakistan is not necessarily a relevant case for all developing countries, so we need to know much more. So there, we would like to do something similar what we currently are doing in the South African case, and in also other countries, not only in Africa, but also elsewhere. It's a great opportunity for somebody like me to work using the South African data. So I'm at the moment, I'm involved in a research project together with the person, Wim Bonsaier from the South African and Treasury, and two fellow researchers from Finland, where we are utilizing this South African registered data to try to estimate the responsiveness of the corporate income tax base on the corporate tax system and the tax rates they have in the South African case. So the idea is to utilize the fact that in South Africa the small business income tax is linearly progressive. So that creates kink points, and the firms have an incentive to locate just below the kink points. And because Kari is a ruthless mediator here, I would have these wonderful slides, but I need to skip them, and so you can only blame Kari. But there's some wonderful work being conducted on this, and it's hopefully give then policy relevant evidence on the extent of elasticity of the corporate income tax base to tax rates in the South African context. So the conclusion is that we are happy to participate in the field experiments, and I think more of those should be done. But in a sense, I would also take one step back and go towards these more traditional topics of building tax benefit microsimulation models and try to estimate the impacts of the existing tax system on taxpayer behavior. And I stop there.